mighty and everlasting Father, we thank you because of the grace we have to know you as a God of love, as a God of affection. Your love towards man preceded man's creation. Before man was created, you have created and put in place all that man needed for survival, for subsistence, for comfort and convenience. Father, we appreciate your love, and we appreciate the gift of your word, the Bible, through which we are able to know who you are, what you are, where you are, and what you have done. Father, accept our thanks and praise to you in Jesus' name. Almighty Father, the entrance of your word giveth light and understanding to the simple. Father, in the name of Jesus, we are praying and asking, Father, that the grace of simple hearts that will enable us to receive your word in and allow your word to touch our life, turn our lives around, and be what you want us to be, and not what we, the world, or the devil wants us to be, you grant unto us in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for what we have heard of your word, what we have read of your word, what we have studied of your word, and we thank you for the changes that your word is making in our life. Father, accept our thanks and praise to you in Jesus' name. Father, the sinners and unbelievers cannot appreciate you. And we are praying and asking, Father, that the grace of your impact of your word upon their life to open their eyes, to see your love, and come from the darkness in which they are to your marvelous light of the gospel, you grant unto them in Jesus' name. We are here for another Bible study. Father, we prepare that. We ask that you prepare our hearts to be able to get the best from the study this morning in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. You are welcome to another Bible study this day. And we are going to consider the second part of our Bible study last week. Last week, we considered believers' pre-salvation benefits from the gracious benefactor. From the story last week, we learned that our God is a benefactor. He's the one that created us and everything that we are enjoying. Before God created man, from that story last week, we saw that he has created everything that man needed. The first thing that God created was light. He simply ordered, let there be light, and there was light. And we have been enjoying that light after we are created. But light has been created before man was created. That's what we learned last week. Last week, we also learned that God created the firmament. The firmament is the space that divided the waters below from the waters above. And that is where we are now. God has created the firmament in readiness for our use. And God created the land. The landmass upon which we operate, now known as the earth, was created by God. If you go and read verse 2 of Genesis chapter 1, we see that the whole space before the commencement of creation was covered by waters of the deep. No land at all. But God said, all the waters will gather together and occupy just about 67% of the space either occupied by the water. And then the remaining 33% now emerged as land. And God now planted everything that we have ever seen as plants in the world. God created them on the third day of his creative work. All the herbs, all the plants, all the flowers, all the grass, all the vegetation and vegetables, God created them on the third day. And then, we are like the sun. The sun is shining now. We are enjoying it. It was created on the fourth day. The sun to rule in the day, and then the moon was created to rule in the night. On the fifth day, God created the birds of the air and the fishes we all eat and enjoy. On the sixth day, God created all animals. By whatever name of description, they were created during the first half of the sixth day. If you have been following me, God has not created man. It was during the second half of the sixth day that God created man. And what did God do? God gave man dominion Dominion means control over every other thing that he has created upon the surface of the earth and in the seas. And God made man the crown of all his creations. Give him brain, give him intelligence, give him intellect, give him mind memory to rule over everything. But after doing this, God put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden and told them, every other thing I've created you're going to enjoy, but there's a particular tree in the center of the Garden of Eden. Don't touch. The day you touch it, you are going to die. What do we learn from there? Let's read Genesis chapter 2, verse 17. It says, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for the day thou eatest thereof, thou shalt die. What lesson are we learning here? Our God will always give us the standard he expects of us in all things. His laws precedes his warning. When his laws are flouted or disobeyed, then we have sinned. So here, God made it plain to Adam and Eve that there is a particular tree in the center of the Garden of Eden. You can eat everything there. Let's take all the trees there to be 100. You see, you can eat of 99, but this particular one don't touch. And for as long as they didn't touch it, no problem. God was even coming to see them in the cool of the day. But Satan came. Satan deceived them. They disobeyed God. They flouted his law. And they sinned. What lesson are we learning there? God has set his standard for me and for you in the Bible as to what he expects of us and what we shouldn't do. And if we will humble ourselves and obey God's commandments, we'll always be at peace with him. But the moment anybody flouts and disobeys the word of God, then it's sin against him. And God is a God of love. When he notices that you are not obeying him, what will he do? He will warn us. God's act of warning is an act of love. If we are traveling along a road, there's a bend. You say that, slow down, there's a bend. If we do not slow down, there will be accident. So it's a warning to avert danger. The same thing with God. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. So, it means that if anyone doesn't sin, he will not die. So, his warnings precede his judgment. And his judgment is final and cannot be escaped. Look at Satan. He was with God. He became proud and pompous, haughty and naughty. God cast him out of heaven. He has been judged. He cannot repent anymore. So, the same thing in the world in which we are. When Adam and Eve sinned, God cast them out of the Garden of Eden. Genesis chapter 3, verse 24. So, he drove them out and placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. So, they are now feeling that they have lost something. And the urge to go back, God saw that the urge to go back would be there. So, God now placed cherubims and flaming sword so that they would not be able to go back. So, and a time came when they were driven out. And despite that, the world population started to continue to grow. So this was after God has driven out Adam and Eve, decided to live a sinful, unrighteous life, and God became unhappy with them. He found only Joshua and his family to be the accepted holy people, and God brought about what we call the flood deluge. God destroyed everything upon the surface of the earth, excepting the family of Joshua. Sorry, of Noah. So, and that is teaching me a lesson that God, our Creator, is not sentimental. He has given us the standard. when they failed. The point I'm making here is that, you know, God destroyed the whole world. The flood covered the whole earth, and consequently, everywhere, you know, every soul was destroyed. All other creatures and creation that God created in the book of Genesis, everything God destroyed, except the specimens of everything that God told Noah to put in the garden of in the boat. So he now blessed Noah and the members of his family. So God could have destroyed everything, but because he found Noah and his family righteous in his sight, what are we learning from there? Our God is a God of holiness and righteousness, a God of purity and perfection. So for you to be able to continue to please God and enjoy his protection, enjoy his preservation, enjoy his provision, enjoy his prosperity, enjoy his promotion, you have to be holy, righteous, pure, and perfect. So God has the power to extinct and destroy the whole world, but he didn't. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 39. This is talking about God's power to kill and to keep alive. See, now that I, even I, am he, and there is no God with me, I kill and I make alive. I wound and I heal. Neither is there anyone that can deliver out of my hand. But thank God, if God decided to wipe up everybody upon the surface of the earth, no one would have prayed him. He spared Noah and his family of it. He blessed them, and that is how the world continued to increase in population again to be about 8 billion people we are now. But the point we are making is that God had a right to kill all the people upon the surface of the earth, but he didn't. What did he do? Let's look at the book of John chapter 3 verse 16. We want to see the love of God manifested. John 3, 16 says, "For God so loved the world." This is part of the benefits that man enjoyed. God could have killed us. No one would have created him. It's unchallengeable. It's unchallengeable, unquerable, unquestionable. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son," Son there in capital letter, referring to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, "that whosoever believeth in him," that is man's role, before you can enjoy the protection of God, the preservation of God, the provisions of God, the blessings of God, you have to believe in his only begotten Son for salvation, and then you begin to enjoy other blessings. "So that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life." Here, Jesus Christ, if we believe in him, we are saved. We believe in him because of our faith in the resurrection, we are justified. And ultimately, if we are able to abide in faith, living holy and righteously, we are going to inherit eternal life. So we see that our Lord Jesus Christ was manifested. God gave him to be able to die and suffer for our sins. So that is a benefit we enjoy after our creation. Let's look at the book of Philippians chapter 2. We are reading from verse 11. "Fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having," from verse 5, "let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in likeness of men." What are we learning there? Jesus Christ is the second personality in the Godhead. But because God desired him, as we read in John chapter 3, verse 16, to come to this world, he now humbled himself. The second personality, he humbled himself and came to this world in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Our Lord Jesus Christ came to this world to die for our sins. No one could have taken his life from him, but he became obedient unto you know, death of the cross. Wherefore, God also hath exalted him and given him a name above every creature, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things in heaven and of things in earth and things under the heaven, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What this passage is telling us, that our Lord Jesus Christ humbled himself. And many people are not saved today because they cannot humble themselves and say, yes, I've sinned. I've committed such and such and such, such sins. God, forgive me. No, they are not able. But look at Jesus Christ, the second personality in the Godhead. For him to come to this world, he has to humble himself. And as believers, we learn a lesson from there. Wherever we find ourselves, there should be no pomposity, there should be no haughtiness, there should be no pride, there should be no naughtiness. We are to humble ourselves. But one thing is this, the moment our Lord Jesus Christ humbled himself, what did God do? After his burial, God resurrected him and exalted him. And he gave him a name above all other names in the heavens and the earth. What are we learning there? If we humble ourselves and accept Jesus Christ as our personal and Savior, God promises to exalt us to be another post-salvation, you know, benefit. God will exalt us above Satan and his cohorts. God will exalt us above the world and his people. God will exalt us above all the works of the flesh. So, exaltation, promotion, elevation awaits sinners who repent of their sins and accept Jesus Christ as their personal and Savior. So, our Lord Jesus Christ humbled himself and gave his life. The book of John chapter 15, verse 13 says, greater love has no man than this, that a man should lay down his life for his friends. My listener, nobody could have taken the life of our Lord Jesus Christ from him. He's the second personality in the Godhead. He has power over the heavens and the earth. But in order to please God the Father for the salvation of our souls, what did he do? He laid down his life. And after his resurrection, when the 11 of the disciples gathered together, you know, in a room, our Lord Jesus Christ met them there. The door was shut. He came in without opening the door. So, if Jesus Christ so desired and he didn't want to lay down his life, what would he have done? He could have disappeared into the thin air. But he surrendered his life. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. So, our Lord Jesus Christ voluntarily relinquished his life, that through his death, we might receive forgiving of our sins, and through his resurrection, we might receive justification. The book of Titus, chapter 2, verse 11. Titus, chapter 2, verse 11. There we learn that through Jesus Christ, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men. My listeners, if you have heard a message on salvation and you have given your life to our Lord Jesus Christ, I congratulate you. If you have not, that grace is appearing to you today. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men. But unfortunately, it's not all men that have been saved. So if you have been saved, I congratulate you. But if you are listening to me now and you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I want to encourage you. There is no other means by which you can be saved. Riches and resources, position and power, authority, whatever you may call it in the world, cannot save us. It is only through faith in the atonement of Jesus Christ at the cross of Calvary that we can be saved. And Jesus Christ has paid that price. So that's why the Bible says, the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Through his sacrificial death, through his substitutional death, through his redemptive death, through his vicarious death on the cross of Calvary, Jesus Christ made available to the entire human being his grace that bringeth salvation to all men. Salvation is now available to every soul that can come upon the name of the Lord. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. Romans 3, verse 23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The fall of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden made all humans, you know, sinners. But over and above that, there's no school of sinning in the whole world. Man sins naturally because he was born as a descendant of Adam and Eve, who fell in the Garden of Eden. So, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But let's look at Romans chapter 10. We are looking at verses 9 to 13. All men are sinners because we are descendants of Adam. But let's look at Romans chapter 10, verses 9 to 13. That if thou shalt confess, we are not looking at what can we do. We inherited Adam's sins. We committed sins with our eyes, with our ears, with our mouth, with our lips, with our hands, with our legs. And how can we get out of it? That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That is a condition very paramount and precedent to salvation of souls. I don't know what sins we have committed. You don't know the one I have committed. But God knows everything. So God now expects you to voluntarily open your mouth and confess that, God, with my eyes, I've committed the following sins, with my ears, with my mouth, with my legs, with any part of my body. So that is very, very paramount. Confession of sins is very paramount to salvation of souls. For with the heart, man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Now that I've repented of my sins, also I've heard about the price, the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for my salvation. Then I believe in my heart, and I want to accept him. For the scripture says, whosoever believeth on him shall never be ashamed. That's one of the post-salvation benefits. Whosoever believeth in Jesus Christ shall never be ashamed. You have given your life to our Lord Jesus Christ. I congratulate you. I pray that you will never be ashamed. I will never be ashamed anymore in Jesus' name. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That is the promise of God. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah, I just make reference to it, chapter 1, verse 18, that come unto me and let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. That is the promise of God for all sinners. So, and when we go to our God the Father, what are we doing? When we are reasoning with him, what are we doing? We are confessing to him. And when we confess unto him in all sincerity, as we are mentioning our sins, our inadequacy, our imperfection, God is noting them because he had the record. So it now says that though your sin be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. What will happen there? God will purge us, God will wash us from all our sins, all our inadequacies, all our imperfections, and we are going to be as white as snow. So that is the promise of God. It has never failed and will not fail in your life if you go to him in Jesus' name. So salvation is available for all sinners that repent of their sins. Now saved and reconciled with God, after confession, what are the post-salvation benefits from our gracious benefactor over the pre-salvation benefits we discussed last week? Number one, let's go to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 10. It says, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. That is promise of eternity. Once we have repented of our sins and accepted Jesus Christ who died for us, we are going to inherit eternal life. Hebrews 2:14. For as much then as the children are partakers of the flesh and blood, he also likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. So the moment you accept Jesus Christ as your personal and savior, then you have control, because Jesus Christ, you are now living in Jesus Christ. If you go and read them, time will not permit us, Colossians chapter 3 verse 3, you know, the moment you give your life to our Lord Jesus Christ, your life is now hid with Christ in God, and Christ is hid in God. So it's not therefore possible for Satan to reach you, because you are protected, you are preserved, you are defended, you are secured and saved in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and God the Father. John chapter 3 verse 16. That's what we read before. All believers in Christ will inherit eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, is the emphasis, should not perish, but do what? But have eternal life. Eternal life is the post-salvation benefit God has given unto us. Then Mark chapter 16 verses 17 and 18. Mark chapter 16 verse 17 and 18. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. After accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we have power to cast out devils. Then they are going to speak in new tongues. Then verse 18. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. We learned a lot there. That power over devils, power over serpents, power over poison, power to heal and to cast out devils. These are post-salvation benefits that we have from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In John chapter 16, verse 33, there we have peace with God and men. Peace engenders progress and prosperity. Proverbs 16, 33 says, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Jesus Christ has overcome the world for us. There will be crises in the world, but they are going to continue to have peace in Jesus' name. Finally, Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. What does he say? He says, but my God, Philippians 4, 19 says, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. My brothers, my sisters, once you accept Jesus Christ as your personal and savior, all your needs spiritual, all your needs physical, all your needs financial, all your needs material, God will continue to supply because of what he has done at the cross of Calvary. Finally, what is grace? Grace means God's riches at Christ's expense. And once you accept Jesus Christ, his grace available unto you. And that is why we as human beings, we have learned about pre-salvation benefits last week. Today we have learned about post-salvation benefits. And all these things are for us to enjoy. I pray that the grace to continue to appreciate what God has done, continue to worship him, continue to praise him, continue to exalt and magnify him as we journey to his kingdom in heaven, God will grant unto us in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, eternity is too short to thank you, to appreciate you for your love towards us regarding the pre-salvation benefits and the post-salvation benefits we discussed last week and today. Father, we pray that having accepted Jesus Christ, the grace to continue to swim and wallow in these benefits, Father, grant unto us in Jesus' name. We pray for those who have not yet accepted Jesus Christ. Father, we want them to come and enjoy the same thing, grace, which are circumstances around them, to be saved and be part of your kingdom in heaven. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.